You're now listening to Sound Talent Media. Check out more shows at soundtalentmedia.com.
Hi, friends. The world got you down? Don't be sad. Listen to $2 Late Fee with Zach and Dustin.
$2 Late Fee is the podcast that celebrates the best decade of entertainment, the 1980s. We pick a movie and soundtrack from our youth that we loved and see if it holds up today. We also interview your favorite celebrities from that era.
All in the spirit of positivity and togetherness. Check us out at $2LateFee.com.
First-time guest Scott Klopfenstein came in hot for his debut appearance, ready to discuss quite possibly the most heartbreaking casualty of the grunge era. The lush compositions and Willy Wonka-inspired look of Jellyfish lacked only one thing: timing. Had they existed a few years earlier or later, the band's trajectory may have been unstoppable. Instead, they got washed away by a sea of flannel and apathy. Is Jellyfish the baby we wish would come back? Stick around to find out.
One hit is all you need to make the money guaranteed, and you can live off royalties forever.
And it makes me wonder, is it just a wonder, or is it one hit thunder?
Scott, I'm really excited because I didn't think we were going to get to talk about Jellyfish, because honestly, I thought that they'd probably be considered a no-hit wonder, but actually, Baby's Coming Back was a minor hit, just enough that our producer Matt Kelly allowed it. He gave it a pass, and I'm really glad he did. Did you choose this song because you're a Jellyfish fan?
I am a Jellyfish fan.
Hell yeah.
I remember seeing the video and hearing the song for Baby's Coming Back, and like, I didn't understand. And I still don't understand. I mean, so this is just kind of a trend through my whole life, is it's like, all, I don't understand what everybody was confused about. It was well arranged, well written, well performed, catchy, thoughtful, like, and fun.
Right.
It made sense. It was everything you want. And I mean, that's just the song. And then you go and you go, oh, well, who the heck are these wacky gentlemen? And then you go and you listen to the record and you're like, oh, the whole thing's dope. But because they weren't grunge or hair metal.
Here was the problem. This is what I landed on when I was doing the research and looking into some of this stuff, is it feels like this band formed because they wanted to create music. I believe they said they wanted to make pop music safe again, but they wanted to push back against hair metal. The problem was that they put out this song in the early part of 1991, while simultaneously another group of musicians were also working to wipe hair metal off the radio, and they would make their appearance just a few months later to also make the world not safe for Jellyfish.
So, right.
Like, it was worst timing that they could have ever put out this record.
They couldn't have picked a worse time to come out. Even 4 or 5 years later, you got Presidents of the United States of America and like kind of crazy, wacky alternative music. Even then might have been the right time. But this was just the worst timing ever. This was at the beginning of grunge.
Well, and you gotta, I mean, like, have you guys found doing this podcast that is so often like the problem? Like the one thing that winds up being a huge factor in a lot of band successes is the timing.
Yeah. Yep.
Like you come out, you know, like, I mean, and to be fair, there are plenty of bands that like who put out music that did smashingly in light of poor timing.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, wasn't Jay-Z's The Blueprint, didn't that get released like right on like September 11th,
yeah,
like when the whole thing happened, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
Like, so there are things that like, depending on, but especially if you're pushing up against which we would then see in the second half of the 90s, that they were trailblazers. Mm-hmm. Because the entire 70s, Queen, Beach Boys, Beatles, all that shit became wildly, like, they just barely missed it with their second record, too.
Yeah.
Which, in my personal opinion, is one of my favorite records of all time.
So I was going to actually lead with that. Spilt Milk, no offense to Belly Button, the album that this is off of, but Spilt Milk was my first. It was the song New Mistake was the first Jellyfish thing I personally ever heard, which I still to this day think is one of the greatest songs ever. That album front to back's amazing, but that song on a musical level, the outro of the song New Mistake is one of my favorite pieces of music ever written. It is so amazing. And this is all very Beatles and Queen inspired music, but I think to bring it back to Belly Button and the timing thing, not only was maybe the music not timed exactly right, but also their look. They came out looking like Willy Wonka, you know, like they're not even disguising. They're trying to look like Willy Wonka. I watched an MTV News segment about them, which I thought was really cool. It was like an extended Kurt Loder hosted MTV News segment that was like 5 minutes long. I'm like, wow, that's pretty cool. They used to do that about Jellyfish. Yeah. And literally Roger Manning from Jellyfish is licking a big swirly lollipop and they're wearing like Cat in the Hat hats. They literally talk about Willy Wonka in it. One thing I had to do a little research here is, so the Willy Wonka, you know, the original Willy Wonka, the Gene Wilder Willy Wonka, came out in 1971. This Belly Button album came out in 1990. So it'd be the equivalent if we came out with a band right now and we dressed like characters in either Kill Bill, House of a Thousand Corpses, or Old School. would be the equivalent of like our whole vibe and look at the time. So the style, the looking at these guys, I feel like I at the time too would have been like, especially when grunge was coming out and you're like, oh yeah, it's flannels and ripped jeans and looking like you don't care about anything, to these like wacky Willy Wonka characters, I may have even been turned off by it despite the music.
But again, when we're talking about timing, it's like, just imagine if it was, you know, 1994, the exact time when they broke up. Like, I could see these guys going on tour with Blind Melon and fitting in beautifully. Like, it's like they just, their career, their short 5 year span was the worst 5 years they could have picked to be an active band.
they could have even gone out with certain Britpop acts and stuff like that. Like there was a lot, or like, you know, I mean, I think about like Apples in Stereo or any of that Elephant Six stuff. Like that was exactly the same thing, just not as poppy. Like it's like
they opened for the Black Crows, which totally makes sense.
Like that
totally fits. But here's the thing about this band though, that I think is cool regardless, right? Maybe they never had the mainstream success that they should have deserved, but they got to work with Ringo Starr, Brian Wilson, William Shatner, and appeared on a Harry Nilsson cover album by Harry Nilsson's personal request that they were one of his favorite active bands. So I feel like at that point, it doesn't matter how popular you are respected by the very people you are like trying to pay homage to, and that sometimes is way more rewarding than if you had like the number one song in America, I think.
True. I mean, I think it's a double-edged sword. You know what I mean? Like, or it's two sides of the same coin, as I think is more of a better example of this duality. Like, because I think, and I mean, this is as an artist myself who could be considered a one-hit wonder. Everyone's always shooting for, I think, both sides. You know, it's like you, the notoriety and the respect of the people who you looked up to and your peers is fantastic. And then to be able to be lifted up by your fan base as well, right?
Yeah.
Whereas it's like they never got never the twain shall meet for them. You know, it's like they had the critical acclaim. And but there were like the fans were like, I mean, I'm sure the fans that they had were go get them. But I mean, like, you know who introduced me to Jellyfish, actually, and brought back, like, because I remember getting Belly Button as a kid and going, okay, but the group of dudes who brought me Spilled Milk were Jesse Carmichael and Adam Levine from Maroon 5.
Wow.
We were on tour together.
And I kind of get that, because that Harder to Breathe album is, like, Songs About Jane is a very 70s throwback record, all things considered.
Yeah, those guys were like, you have to check this out. And because they're huge Queen fans, they're huge The Who fans.
But I feel like, so we've mentioned Queen, we've mentioned The Who, we've mentioned The Beatles, but when I listened to Spilt Milk, because I listened to it for the first time today, to Spilt Milk, I heard more than any other band, Supertramp. Like, this is a Supertramp record, if
it's
anything.
They got compared to Supertramp a lot.
Yeah.
Well, I think that that's part of the problem, too, right? Like, everything that I read, like, because I went and I read, like, the Wikipedia and read some other stuff. And I think it's a huge problem with a lot of the music industry, just to begin with, which is the comparisons that people make to try to quantify and then categorize what's happening can be the fucking death rattle of any creative force.
Yep.
Like, instead of just being open to it and accepting it for what it is, and then, like, as you've, like, accepted something, you start to break down its components. Like, I never listen to something and go, oh, that's that, and that's that, and that's that, because it cheapens the art. Like, everything is something.
Right.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, we can sit and listen to Bjork and be like, oh, there's some fucking Schubert, and, like, you know, it's
I think,
like,
that might be an exception, Scott. I don't know if Bjork sounds like anybody.
But that's the thing, is that
I disagree, because remember I texted you that the Sugar Cubes sounded exactly like the B-52s when I finally listened to them.
Fair enough. Yeah. But, like, I mean, it's all somewhere, you know what I mean? And this desire to, like, that, I don't know. I mean, it's kind of human nature as well. But yeah, I feel like every time it was like, oh, these guys are into Queen, when Queen, it's not cool to be into Queen. Tell me when it's not fucking cool to be into Queen.
Right. Well, people in general need an RIYL. They need a recommended if you like. It's just for the lowest common denominator, who aren't going to just check out a band. And there's a few things we got to talk about with this band that set them apart. And one of the first obvious things is all the members of the band. Andy Sturmer, being the lead singer and, you know, writes most of the songs,
is the drummer.
Stand-up drummer. He is a stand-up drummer and lead singer. And the band stands in a straight line across the stage. And I would highly recommend that people go watch the Jules Holland performance of, I think they played,
oh, it's so rad.
I think they played The Ghost at number one on there. And it's just,
yeah,
every harmony is flawless. Everything is amazing. Yet, Scott, I mean, we've both played with a lot of bands in our day. I don't think I've ever seen a band with a stand-up drummer lead singer. Have you?
Not a stand-up drummer lead singer, but the drummer for the Violent Femmes.
I was literally going to say Violent Femmes was a stand-up drummer for sure.
Yeah.
Well, I just went and saw the Eagles too, and Don Henley played a few songs while drumming and playing too. So it's not that it hasn't been done, but the stand-up drummer I had never seen. Yeah. I sent that video last night to my band and our drummer Corey and said, hey, dude, do you think you could start standing and playing? He's like, I'll do my best. All right. Well,
you know, Chris, you're doing a podcast with a guy who was a drummer lead vocalist in a very popular local band.
Did you stand?
No, I sat. Okay. But but for our 3 months of shows, I taught myself how to sing and drum simultaneously and was bad at both.
But I mean, Phil Collins? had Phil Collins done it, you know, it would have been an easier transition.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But he had to sit down and sing.
Well, and Scott, as a fan of both, you know, obviously Real Big Fish, but also Littlest Man Band and all of the other solo stuff you're doing, the second that I hit play on Jellyfish, I heard, oh, okay,
huge.
I hear so much Jellyfish even in that. You know what I mean? Like, it's just so heady, and it's got all these different genres meshing together into these sounds that, you're right, like, boiling it down to just, oh, they're doing the classic rock thing is kind of discounting all of the otherness that's
mixed
into it.
Oh, it's so reductive.
Yeah.
Like, it's so dismissive and reductive. Like, what they were doing was bringing a level of musicianship and sophistication into songwriting, back into songwriting. Like, I mean, because, you know, it's like, okay, so in the 90s, right, we're seeing the end of like the new romantic era of electronic music and like new wave and stuff like that. Like everything was getting really like, we were losing a certain amount of dynamics to music, I think, personally. Like, I mean, there was a lot of cool stuff happening in alternative music as far as, like, you know, the Pixies. But, like, there was a lot happening on the pop sense of things that there were very few instances in pop music where, like, dynamic changes and quick turnarounds and, like, just thought, this great deal of thoughtfulness that didn't always play submissive to the idea of groove, right? Don't break the groove because you might lose people. Like, that's really where I think we started to, like, Jellyfish was like, right, we can set a feel and then do a quick turnaround, do some cut time, do a place where the drums go away and it's just vocals and then bring it all back. Like, they wanted to take people on a journey every single time. Well, instead of give people like a piece of candy, you know, and it's like,
right.
I'm also, you know, it's like, I'm a Zappa fan too. So it's like, I appreciate the idea of like being able to go somewhere every time you sit down to hear something that somebody made.
Let me propose this too. Cause as we're talking about how there's that 5-year period that they were a band, that they were just the wrong 5-year period. And I had this thought running through my head the other day where I was thinking about, like, what were the bands whose careers weren't destroyed by Nirvana and grunge? Like, who were the bands that had a career in the 80s and continued to have a career into the 90s? And, like, you know, like, U2 came up as a band in my brain that were still releasing hit records, Aerosmith, and then REM. And I feel like, if Jellyfish had started at the same time as REM, they would have probably been lumped into like bands that Kurt Cobain was listening to and said like, oh, this is like what is driving this. Because like Kurt Cobain is such a huge REM fan as well. Like it,
yeah.
Like it, I think that they would have even had a chance of being that cult band that wasn't blowing up yet in the 80s, but like were part of the inspiration for like what became the alternative music scene in the early 90s, but they just literally the time, like we said, the timing was horrendous.
Horrendous.
I agree with everything you're saying, Scott. They had a lot of dynamics. They weren't afraid to take the listener on a journey. That's something I've always liked about music and strove to write, is taking listeners on a journey.
Oh, for sure. For sure.
I have mad respect for the songs that put you in a groove and keep you there the whole time. I love that. But Jellyfish were something else. It was an adventure. It's a music. When you listen to Spilt Milk, that album, you're all over the place. You know, it puts me in the mind sometimes. Yeah. If you listen to Ben Folds, I feel Ben Folds in that. I feel, you know, obviously Beatles and Queen and everything, but everywhere you can go in that album. But another thing that I think they fell victim to is all the hair metal. I'm not a fan of hair metal. I'm just not. It's not my thing. I preferred Boys to Men. I was a little kid, but I was more into Boys to Men than I was the hair metal. But the one thing about the Jellyfish albums, especially Spilt Milk, was that it was very produced. It was very over the top produced. And now when grunge comes along and the Steve Albini produced things, these very stripped down to just rock band arrangements, you know, even though they weren't necessarily a hair metal or glam band or whatever, I think it was just a complete rejection of all things produced. Or, you know, it could be argued that Jellyfish is almost overproduced. Yeah, the collection of artists that they got together to make these albums. Now, I want to name some of these people. First of all, they got this dude. Oh, what's his name? Let me look it up.
Jason Faulkner.
Well, we'll talk about Faulkner, but no, Albie Gallutin, the producer.
Oh, yeah.
Who was responsible for pretty much every Bee Gees hit song. That's who they brought in. So you have him, and then apparently, and this is said about a lot of people, songwriters, musicians, apparently Andy Sturmer was very hard to work with. And by the time Spilt Milk came along, Jason Faulkner was no longer involved. For anyone who doesn't know Jason Faulkner's music, the dude's like insane. I heard an album from like the past recent years by him that was insane. And he was part of a group after Jellyfish called the Grays, where another person who played on Spilt Milk, which I didn't even know he played on Spilt Milk until recently, John Bryan.
Oh, right. Yeah. But no, oh, that Jason Faulkner record. It's Jason Faulkner and R. Stevie Moore.
Dude,
right?
With the clown on the cover or whatever, has like terrible artwork. Yeah. That thing is insane. Just the.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you haven't heard R. Stevie Moore, his stuff, oh my gosh. The only way I can explain him that comes to mind right now is he is like the Daniel Johnston version of Harry Nilsson.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
well, I'm checking that out.
He is hugely influential on bands like Dr. Dog. Mm-hmm. R. Stevie Moore is just this dude who was like, I don't think he had ever really had a hit, but great songwriting, like, really wild stuff, but he would just rent gear and fill his house full of gear and record stuff. Kind of Brian Jonestown Massacre kind of thing.
That was another band I was thinking about with Jellyfish, is that Brian Jonestown Massacre, Dandy Warhol's era, if they had held out a little bit longer and hopped on that like 60s, garage rock throwback, I think they would have fit in. Again, every other era but the era that they put out music.
They Scott, that R. Stevie Moore and Jason Faulkner album, that's the one I'm talking about. With Another Day Slips Away on it, that song where it just, oh my God, the key changes in that song. The way it's just
insane.
Yeah, it's insane. It's like almost like music nerds music, but somehow it still has a pop feel to it. Oh, it's so good. But the reason we're bringing this up is because Jason Faulkner was on that, on the Belly Button album, on the album where Baby's Coming Back is on. And I will say this, I'm going to throw Matt Kelly under the bus right now. He was not impressed with Jellyfish. And I'm like, dude, have you listened to Spilt Milk? Because I could almost see why, if you were just basing it off Baby's Coming Back, I might think it's fluff. I might be like, yeah, that's a good song, but it's kind of fluff.
For sure. And I mean, and Belly Button, you know, like it doesn't start as a banger.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like it's like that record starts kind of chill. I mean, you know, The Man I Used to Be is a really chill, introspective tune.
Right.
It's not like we're coming out the door, rock. It's not like Spilled Milk, which is like it gives you this like prayer, you know, like their own version of Prayer by the Beach Boys. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, you know, which I felt like they were like, oh, OK, hair metal. Here you go.
Right. Yeah. Bam. No, my opinion definitely changed upon listening to Spilled Milk, because I was like, this is fine. Like, I'll never listen to this again. Then I listened to Spilt Milk and I was like, I want to listen to this a lot today. Like, this is going to be, as soon as I'm done recording this, I'm just going to listen to more Spilt Milk. I do want to talk about April 6, 1999, specifically. That is the day that the song peaked on the Billboard charts. Sorry, 1991. Peaked at 62 on the charts. And I also wanted to just double check, September is when Nirvana hits, right? So this is what the musical landscape is in a pre-Nirvana world. Your number one song in America is Gloria Estefan's Coming Out of the Dark. Some of the other songs peppered amongst the top 10 is Enigma's Sadness Part 1.
Sadness.
S-A-D-E-N-E-S-S. So I guess that's sadness.
Really?
Yeah.
It's sadness. It's definitely sadness. It's that song goes, sadness.
Well, Sadness Part 1. Amy Grant's Baby Baby, Tesla's Signs, and a Chris Fafalius favorite, Another Bad Creation.
Aisha.
But then I tried to comb through the entire Hot 100, searching for anything that would remotely have fallen into the Jellyfish realm, which as I kept scrolling, I was like, I'll just take anything that would have been on rock radio or you know, whatever. All I could find was The Vinyls I Touch Myself, Chris Isaac, Wicked Game, Queen Strike, Sweet Lucidity.
Queen Strike.
Oh yeah, I always say that wrong. God damn it. Black Crowes, She Talks to Angels, and Firehouse, Don't Treat Me Bad.
Oh.
This song was sandwiched between Sheena Easton's What Comes Naturally and Cinderella's Heartbreak Station. Like, this is what the music landscape is in early 1991. I'm saying I'm sorry that Jellyfish was a casualty in this, but I'm also kind of really glad that Nirvana kind of came and cleaned the board off a little bit and gave us a fresh...
shook things up. Like, it's so crazy. Like, and there are, like, You know, you were right. Like, I was, because it, when I think about, you know, them opening for the Black Crowes, I was like, does that really work? And then you're like, oh, I mean, in that era of the Black Crowes, she talks to angels. Like, I mean, that, look, that song, whatever is whatever it is, but it, there's actually, it's actually a good, it's a well-written tune.
I think that that's one of the, I'm not the biggest Black Crowes fan, but I think that that is a very good song. It's a well-constructed, pretty song.
I mean, Flaming Lips. Wouldn't the Flaming Lips and Jellyfish be the ultimate?
Oh, my
that's
God.
That would have been amazing.
Yeah. When did they hit?
Oh, 80s.
Yeah, they were an 80s band, really? But she Don't Use Jelly was like 94 or 95. Like, they were another.
That's all they had to do. Yeah. Jellyfish just had to hold on. They just had to hold out until She Don't Use Jelly hit. And then, you know, She Don't Use Jellyfish. They were right in the door. They needed to just hold on a little bit longer. That's it.
I know. I mean, it's like I could have seen them with a band. I mean, I could have even, on a stretch, seen them with Ween. You know what I mean?
Like, yes.
Though Ween was far more chaotic and bombastic and off the wall, like, there was still that Ween fans have a sensibility of open, a sense of open-mindedness. I mean, you have to, because you never know what you're going to get. After 94, there were so many opportunities, so many possibilities. I mean, what was, as the Flaming Lips, I mean, what would have been the album that came out in the 90s for them? I mean, early 90s for them.
When they dropped Belly Button, they put out In the Priest-Driven Ambulance for the Flaming Lips.
Okay,
And then Hit to That's Death early. In the Future Head in 92. And then after they broke up is when they put out Transmissions from the Satellite Heart.
Yeah. Yeah, Transmissions from the Satellite Heart would be the one that would be, I mean, though, again, that's that, you know, and again, like Transmissions from the Satellite Heart, though, I think the songwriting would have been complimentary. The production style and approach is, again, a lot more raw, a lot more lo-fi, and so would have been a bizarre juxtaposition just sonically.
Well, in that time, it's only those few years, that 91, maybe 92, 93, when the whole the Seattle grunge bands were hitting. It was after that, it was like a major label crazy for any weird band. I mean, you're talking about the time where, you know, think about 120 minutes at that time when bands, you brought up Ween, Chibo Motto.
Yeah.
You know, all these like
everyone was trying to replace Kurt Cobain. They were trying to find, well, Kurt was gone and they had a Kurt shaped hole, and every record label was trying to find the next Nirvana.
But it allowed for weird music. And Scott, it's almost like it led to, you know, the ska boom of the 97, 98. It even led into that. You know, it was different. It was different sounding and fun, you know, bright. I associate bright colors and stuff with that time. Think of that, Jellyfish, you know, same kind of thing.
What we're talking about, right? Like, in my brain, it's Kurt Cobain dies in 94. All these record labels try to find the next Kurt Cobain, which means that we have this over influx of just moody, depressing music. So of course, when all of a sudden you've got like sell out, bam, like you have like this upbeat, happy thing, which is the opposite of what is the only thing on alternative radio at that time. Of course, there was going to be this huge flip and people being like, oh, you know what? Like, maybe I want to be happy for a little bit. And like, let's not forget the fact that as I think we talked about on our Real Big Fish episode, and I've definitely talked about on other podcasts, like, just because ska music sounds happy doesn't mean that there aren't like some heavy ass topics and some really depressing moody shit in there too.
Absolutely.
It's just the veneer of happiness with the music.
Yeah.
It wasn't just ska. I mean, Scott brought up Ween.
Yeah.
I mean, Push the Little Daisies was obviously like the Beavis and Butthead put Ween on the map song, but it's just, there was so much weird indie by the mid 90s, by the time the Seattle thing calmed down a little bit and it was kind of like everywhere and just alternative music was just weird. And you know,
you brought up Presence of the United States. Goes. They're a great one to throw in there too. Cause they were
great
just
example.
So weird and out there.
Yeah.
I mean, the Butthole Surfers, like, sure, we're on the radio. I mean, it was amazing. I almost feel a little disillusioned as a kid. I really dove into, well, and I guess now, I mean, early 90s too, but it's like there were things like, you know, bands like Ned's Atomic Dustbin and things like that.
Two bass players.
Yeah. You know, that allowed for some forward movement into interesting things. Mm-hmm. And then all of us, and then somewhere in the 90s, the industry just gave up on interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And has never really come back. I mean, I feel the industry hasn't exactly come back, but through the grace and mixed feelings of the internet and things like that, people have been able to create more of what they actually want and need without the good graces of, and so the industry has had to change. But that's a further conversation.
Yeah.
And Jellyfish, unfortunately, they talked about the thing that I read, they did a limited run box set of like all of the, like everything they could get their hands on of Jellyfish, and they only made 8,000 of them, and they sold out like very quickly.
Yeah, they have a cult following for sure. But there's something, you know, after the breakup of the band, which, you know, they did over the phone, Andy Sturmer and Roger Manick.
I think this is done. I was thinking the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah, right. And they broke up, but where Andy Sturmer went is insane. I never put the two and two together. All I know is that some point in the past decade, maybe longer, I heard Puffy Amiyumi's joining a fan club, and I was like, holy shit. How is there a Jellyfish song? How? And it was just this hyper pop, you know, version done by this Japanese pop group. And I was like, how is this possible? How did this happen? And then, you know, in researching this, it's like, that's what Andy Sturmer did. He wrote for them, and then he wrote for a lot of Disney and Cartoon Network shows, I think, is where his career went.
What's up, everybody? I am Finn McKenty, host of the Punk Rock NBA podcast, part of the Sound Talent Media podcast network. My podcast is all about doing what you love for a living, and every week I sit down and talk to people who have done exactly that. For example, musicians like Tommy from Between the Buried Me, Matt from Periphery, Lil Lotus and Shinigami, among many others, photographers, artists, designers, YouTubers like Glenn Fricker and Sarah Dici, and I unpack exactly how they got to where they are today with the goal of helping you do the same. So if that sounds cool, you can listen and subscribe at soundtalentmedia.com, and I'll see you there.
Hi, this is Krista Makes, host of Krista Makes a Podcast. The theme of the podcast is songwriting. Each week, my musical guest picks a defining song from their career to discuss, critique, and analyze during the show. So please join me for some fun and insight into some of the greatest songs ever written and recorded. Listen and subscribe at soundtalentmedia.com.
Hey, do you have an idea for a podcast but don't know where to start? Or do you have an already existing podcast that you want to take to the next level? Well, check out weknowpodcasting.com. From concept development to theme music to editing to logos, weknowpodcasting.com is a one-stop shop for all things pod. Don't hesitate to hit us up. We're very nice. Apparently, he's still very elusive. He doesn't really do interviews, doesn't talk much. I don't know. I wasn't able to confirm that. I haven't seen anything recent with him. But yeah, it seems like he had a cool, successful career after that, probably making enough money from that he's like, screw it. I don't need to release music to try to be famous that way anymore.
Yeah. I mean, and it's a, you know, cartoon music, it's a good gig. You can get away with a lot in cartoon music, I think.
A lot of the people who do the cartoon music are, I feel like they want you to be weird and wacky, right? Like you have to match the vibe of the show, so they don't want like just a simple 4/4 like toe tapper. Yeah. They want you to get out there and strange.
Yeah, I mean, what's his name from Shudder to Think does, you know, like scoring and stuff like that, too. Craig, right? Craig? I don't remember. But
I know Jeff Rosenstock does that,
Jeff
too.
Jeff does Craig of the Creek. I tried to do that. I'm not very good at it.
It's definitely a skill of its own thing.
Oh, it's a whole thing. I don't do well with making things that blend in. I don't play nicely with anything.
Yeah. That'd be hard, but yeah. Hey, another thing, you know, a couple other little things that may not have helped Jellyfish. They were recording Spilt Milk in L.A. during the L.A. riots. That seems like a bad omen in itself. Yeah. Like, they're literally in L.A. recording during the L.A. riots. And that album, when Spilt Milk came out, which once again, if anyone here listening hasn't listened to Spilt Milk, after you finish this episode, just put it on. By the end of it, you're going to be like, oh my God, how did I never hear this before?
But like, put it on. I recommend you find yourself a high res, like lossless version of it. This is a truly incredible piece of production. Mm-hmm. The arrangements are unreal. Like, they are so thoughtful. The performances are fantastic. Their ability to create melody and counter melodies and their counterpoint. I mean, we're working with strings and harpsichords, and like, the instrumentation is unbelievable, and it's all practical. There's no like sequencing or, and it's astounding, and it is beautiful. And you don't hear records like this anymore. I mean, I think about some of my favorite records that remind me of a certain type of sensibility as this. So the one thing that comes to mind, and something that was wildly influential on me too, was like Jeremy Enoch's Return of the Frog Prince.
Okay.
Right? Which again, you're talking about strings and harmonies and all sorts of stuff, but not to the like, I don't know anything of the 90s that went to the lengths to create a sonic soundscape as rich and beautiful and joyous. You know, I mean, because it's like, one could say that like, okay, computer, I'm not, that's an incredible piece of music. It's but joyous?
No.
Yeah. I don't know.
that it is not. That it is not. It is, those are two albums that I recently, Scott, got AirPod Pros. My friend Johnny hooked me up with AirPod Pros, and I had never listened to music through those before.
Yeah.
And now these are two albums that I want to listen to through those and experience them that way.
Yeah.
You know?
But realize also, though, with AirPod, because I have the Pros as well, you're still going to lose a little bit just because Bluetooth is not the greatest way to transfer music. So you really got to listen hard. I mean, I have a pair of expensive studio mixing headphones that when I really want to go somewhere, I'm in my office, I have the FLAC files, I sit down, I plug it in, I burn some incense,
there you go.
Put on my lights, I close, my dog curls up on my lap, and I just like go, because it's like, this record is really like, because, I mean, it was something that we were always trying to capture, too, because we were like when we did Why Do They Rock So Hard?
Ooh,
Jellyfish was a hugely influential band in that for us.
Yeah.
And so we were like, how more harmonies and more interesting instruments and stuff like that to try to capture. And it's trying to get that thing where it's like somewhere between the raw punchiness of the grunge sound and the beauty of like a glam rock pop sound. I don't know that anybody has ever done it. To my satisfaction, but I'm an old person.
We got to stress, we're talking about Spilt Milk here. This is This is not the album that the song we're talking about.
Right. Sorry,
the
I know
we're barely talking about, but
that
that's
one,
fine.
That one's fine. That one is fine, but we're talking about the album after that, Spilt Milk, which is a massive
which is hit. Crazy because of the fact that the album that they had the hit on was not their greatest one. Like,
no, not at all.
Oh, it's so frustrating.
Well, so I'm sitting here and I'm trying to think of like, what are some albums that kind of hit that same vibe that you're talking about, where it's like, it's beautifully produced, it's got all these layers, it's taking you on a journey, and like you said, the element of joyfulness. And this is gonna sound wild, but two albums came to my mind by the same person, two separate bands, same person, would actually be The Format's Dog Problems and the first Fun album, Aim and Ignite. I feel like Nate was very focused in like bringing in like lots of orchestration, horns, like this, specifically the title track, Dog Problems, like that fucking feels like an All You Need Is Love era Beatles song with like,
very true.
Like, it's like he was really trying. I don't think he succeeded nearly to the level that Spilt Milk is, but that's honestly the only thing I can think of over almost a 20-year period
think of one that just came out. I can think of one that came out in the past 2 months.
All right. Oh, and I know what you're going to say.
and Scott, if you haven't heard this album yet, this new Gang of Youths album.
Oh,
dude, if you haven't listened and experienced that thing yet, Okay. I think it's one of the best albums ever, but it's everything. It's everything we're talking about. The orchestrations, the journey it takes you on.
You know what? I saw an article on Gang of Youths, and I'll be honest, I think they're the picture of them. I was like,
no.
I don't know.
No, don't judge them. They're amazing. They're unbelievable. Believe me. Yeah. Yeah. They might be wild looking, but they're like Australian. Cut them some slack.
Oh, no, it's not. Okay, this is something else. But this is, oh, great. No, because I always love the Australian
Me too,
acts.
Man. Australia comes
We've
hard.
We've been talking about
Australia
it, dude.
Australia comes hard in recent years. Australia and New Zealand,
time.
Man. That band, The Beths. Do you like The Beths?
Yeah, The Beths are great. Hiatus Coyote.
I want to say every one-hit wonder that we've talked about that came from Australia, by the end of it, we're like, this band should have been huge. Like,
Scott, are you, I mean, my favorite artist of all time, and I'm only bringing this up because she's another one that you could very easily, several albums, specifically to me, Vespertine, but are you a big Bjork fan?
Love Bjork.
I think that Vespertine album is like a perfect, like, just the orchestral arrangements and the Inuit singers and the Matmos stomping on ice to create a beat and stuff. It's just, it's all insane. You know, it's all,
I mean, the one I keep going back to, surprising, 'cause I love Vespertine, is just for its pure, like, ingeniousness. Is that a word? I don't know.
Sure.
Is Medulla.
Dude, that's the one that reignited my love, because I watched like a documentary about the making of it, and seeing Rozelle and Mike Patton in there, and it just that reinvigorated. I already liked her, but that's when I became obsessed. That's when I have to own everything Bjork ever did on, you know, every live DVD, every record, every B-sides remix album. That's when I became, that's when she became my favorite artist. Yeah.
I mean, there's
challenging, there's some challenging songs on that, though.
I mean, and that's always like, and that's, I think, how I was lucky enough to find and be open to Jellyfish when they came about. And I'm always down for the challenge. Like, I always want to find something I don't understand.
Me too, man.
Right? Like, I am not a passive music listener. I want to be assaulted.
Yeah.
I want to be made uncomfortable.
Yep.
I want to be, you know, like, and I mean, every, you know, like this morning I put on the new, the weather station, the one that's all just mostly piano, you know, 'cause it's like, we're getting the morning going and stuff like that, but like getting lost in her lyrical content, you know, like I want something. When my first daughter was born, my wife would come home often, and I was doing some, you know, we were like, I was stay at home dadding, and I would put on, do you know the record Pillow Wand?
No.
It's Nels Klein and Thurston Moore and just their guitars.
Huh.
And it's just them improvising in the studio. It is the best. And it's sometimes it's noisy and crazy, and then they click into something and it's just brilliant. But like, she'll come home and it's like, and it's me and my child like passed out. And she's like, what is happening here? And I was like, I don't know. And it kind of explains why my eldest is the way she is. You know, yeah, like I want, and I feel like that's, even that first Jellyfish record, you know, Belly Button is a challenging listen. It demands to be sat and listened to. It's got some great pop moments on it. Great pop moments on it. It has some unbelievably endearing lyrical content, introspective and vulnerable. You know, they talked about, you know, at a certain point, what was it, Roger Manning just all of a sudden wanted to be Leonard Cohen, but
no, it was Andy. It was Andy Starr.
Oh, it was Andy. That's right. Yeah. Andy wanted
Roger
to be Leonard
wanted to
Cohen.
Keep it. He wanted to keep it like Brit poppy or whatever.
But like, yeah, you hear like the poetry and the vulnerability and the fear and the anxiety that Andy was going through. Like, and he wasn't, as much as he didn't like being a lead person, he never shied away from putting his heart on the table for everyone to see.
So as you're describing that, I'm thinking of yet another band that if they had just held on a little bit longer, probably would have became their musical peers. But like, all the ways that you're describing Belly Button is how I've described Electroshock Blues by the Eels to people.
Oh,
where it's just
what,
like,
a great record.
You know what I mean? Where it's just like, this is just a heartbreaking personal album that has so much incredible production going on it, and somehow, while it's being the most depressing shit you've ever listened to, ends on like the most hopeful song for the future that's like ever been recorded. Like, it, that is another Journey one where if you just listen to those songs as themselves, you don't hit, it doesn't resonate with you the way that if you like actually right. sit there and start with Elizabeth on the Floor and end with P.S. You Rock My World, you're like, okay, I get what this is, just a dude's documentation of the worst year of his entire life.
Yeah.
I mean, when was that record? That was 96?
96, again, if he 96. Just held out.
Where we also had the Software Slump, right?
Yeah.
By Granddaddy.
Yeah.
It's like a weird, like, suicide note from a friend.
Yeah.
You know, I think, I mean, well, and I think, again, if it's amazing how important... We all talk about it, but I don't know if we can even quantify it, how important Kurt Cobain was. Kurt's death in 94 made people open and to a certain a great amount of things that happened over the next 4 to 5 years in music. You know, some real darkness, not just anger, mm-hmm. but real darkness. But talking about suicide in a way that was largely vulnerable, because I feel like there were a lot of situations, or just death in general, that people were willing to not candy coat the idea of loss. And
I mean,
you know,
how many heroin songs were there that never sounded like it was a fun time? They were, yeah. they weren't writing about, you know, you don't listen to those early Alice in Chains albums and think, man, these guys are having a blast with this heroin. Like, it's like,
yeah, right?
Please for help in song. Like,
yeah.
Well, Matt, we've heard a lot of upbeat heroin songs, though. Keep in mind that Cracker song. Remember
oh
that
yeah,
Cracker
low.
Song?
Yeah, low is pretty
is
upbeat.
It low?
I think
oh, okay.
so.
There's that 1975 song that sounds like a love song. Anyway, I mean,
Needle in the Damage Done is kind of upbeat.
Yeah. There, people make happy songs about it too.
So I do want to bring up one last thing, actually tied to the song.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry.
But in 2007, in a very weird full circle kind of way, there was a power pop group from England called McFly, who most
oh, yeah.
people don't know unless they watched a really bad Lindsay Lohan movie starring them. But they're actually a really good power pop band. But in 2007, they covered Baby's Coming Back, and it became a number one hit in the UK. So Jellyfish
really?
Couldn't get this song past 61 on the US charts. But when that pop influence went back to where it came from in Britain, they were able to get that number one hit somehow.
Wow.
Well, how did Belly Button chart in the UK? Did it do better than it did in the States?
I'm sure it had to.
It had to. Everything well, over there does better. I mean, not everything, but they're so much more open-minded.
Well,
and I feel like Spilt Milk did better over there, too.
I saw Spilt Milk in the United States peaked at number 165 on the Billboard.
In the UK, it was 21.
Not very good.
21.
And then, yeah, on the UK, yeah, it did chart a little bit higher. It charted at 51, but they had 7 songs chart in the UK charts versus the one in the States. So, you know, they were a modest success in the UK at the time. Their biggest hit was The King Is Half Undressed in the UK,
which is a good song.
Hey, we on Spilt Milk too, we got to touch real quick on John Bryan was involved.
Oh yeah.
A lot on Spilt Milk album. For anyone who is not familiar with John Bryan, he's like, I don't know, probably one of the greatest musical minds of our lifetime, I guess you could say. He was
yeah.
largely responsible for, okay, I can't say that I like Kanye West anymore, but Jesus Christ, that Late Registration album is one of the greatest albums of all time. And
yeah.
John Bryan had a very large part in that
well,
album.
Yep. I mean, when I think of John Bryan, I also think of his film scores.
Yeah.
Where he came in
yeah.
and did the scores for Magnolia, Punch Drunk Love, right. Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, I Heart Woo! Huckabees, Lady Bird, and the new Christopher Robin movie from like 2018. Like
wow.
very just nice, laid back, moody piano. There's a 26-second piece of music that he did for Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind that for years was my most listened to piece of music, which was Elephant Parade. Thank you. just stunningly gorgeous.
Have either of you had a chance to see him live?
Dude, I've heard about these shows that he would play all the time. I guess in LA where he would just people just yell out any song and he would just play it, right?
So yeah, so he came to New York one time. My wife and a friend and I went and saw him, and it was hands down probably one of the top five musical moments, not performances, moments of my life.
Yeah,
it's just a stage and a bunch of instruments all mic'd up, and him. He built tunes by himself. And then did grooves and wrote things and did all this stuff and then played his own stuff, which was dope. And what's the Beatles song? Aladdin, light downstream, it is not dying. I always forget the name.
Tomorrow Never Knows.
Tomorrow Never
Love
Knows.
Love that song.
He built that tune by himself. Even the pew, pew, the seagull thing, he did that. And then he does this thing, and he did it a few times. I think he did it three times, where he just goes, call out three songs.
Oh yeah.
And a musical style. And it was like, I can't even remember what he did, but just random tunes, and he calls them out and they call out a musical style. And then he does like a mashup of the three songs at the same time, moves through all their parts and like in this musical style by himself. Yeah. And it's like, you're like, oh, you can do anything, because he sees the Matrix.
Right.
He's so good that he's like, he can take a song, break it down into all of its parts. You know, it's like he's like a chef that's like, I know how to cook so well that if you ask me to make a souffle, I can just do it from memory because I know everything that goes into it. You know, like, you know, and so it. I just sat there mouth agape. At the true, I don't like to use this word, but the true genius of John Bryan. I mean, the sadness that I experienced when, because have you heard, I mean, this was about Jellyfish, but Fiona Apple, which she was famous for doing When the Pawn, the production there. And so there is a version of the album Extraordinary Machine that John Bryan did the whole record. I have a copy of that record. It's the entirety of the Extraordinary Machine record, and it is amazing.
And that's not what was released? You're saying that he produced it first or something?
He produced the entire record. The record was completely recorded and not mixed. Huh. And somebody said no.
Wow.
And so Fiona said, okay, which was surprising. And I think there's only two songs on what was released as Extraordinary Machine. I mean, the title track, Extraordinary Machine, and then something else possibly that they kept what he did. And the rest of it was produced by some pop guy. I can't remember. But it's like, I don't, what was released of Extraordinary Machine is, I mean, the songs are great, but the production's not my favorite. But if you hear this, you can find it online, I'm sure. It's just breathtaking.
Yeah.
Yeah, I checked. And, the wiki has it listed as the bootleg release.
And the point of all this, in case we lost any listeners with this, the point of all this is this guy that we've been ranting and raving about for the past 6 or 7 minutes, he's also involved in
the Jellyfish.
Spilt milk, in the Jellyfish camp. I mean, Jason Faulkner, John Bryan, you got this Albee guy who produced all the Bee Gees hits. You got Andy Sturmer and Roger Manning, who are badasses.
Phenomenal songwriters.
It is just the collaboration of all these musical minds to create this musical journey that's still very catchy and poppy and happy and joyous, as Scott described it. I mean, at the end of these episodes, we always decide, hey, did this song or this artist bring the one hit thunder, or was it a one hit blunder? I mean,
I don't think we've ever had less of a need to ask this question.
Yeah, I mean, I think Matt, I would say Sinead O'Connor, Nothing Compares to You. We didn't need to discuss that at all. we knew that was thunderous, but yeah, I mean, I think this is pretty obviously thunder. I mean, the only blunder is they didn't keep being a band, but obviously everyone was successful in their own ways.
Yeah.
Timing blunder.
It's timing. Well, and it's like, what's the thing that they say, that luck is like preparation meets timing?
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
Yep.
And they had the preparation. I mean, they talked about, you know, and everything that I've read, they said, you know, the demos that they made were what was recorded. Like they took the meticulous time. These were no slouches. These weren't dudes who relied heavily on a producer coming in. And, you know, these weren't cats that were like, oh, we're, you know, we need our George Martin to teach us, you know, how orchestrations work. They knew already. They knew how arrangements work. They were on the money.
Right.
It's just they this weird window of time when, like, what they were doing. I mean, because I think, yeah, if they had been earlier, they would have been successful. Had they been later, they would have been successful. It's a cruel world.
Yeah. Go watch their Jules Holland performance and you'll see. I don't know, man. You know, the last thing I would leave us with is, can a band with a stand-up drummer lead singer, would it ever have happened? Would they have needed to, like, get a drummer? Okay, Andy, you could be the front man. We'll get a drummer. Could that have been a problem?
Yeah. I mean, maybe he would have stayed the drummer if he'd have played sitting down. Like, if that was his issue. If he didn't like being the front man, then sit down and sing. Like, that's what what's his name from Slow Gherkin did it just fine.
Yeah. So that maybe that's the one question is, could a band with a stand-up lead singer drummer become famous? Yeah. But otherwise, Jellyfish, thunderous.
Thunderous.
Yeah.
And one last thing, you know, Scott, at the time that we're recording this, you just celebrated 200 live streams. Where can people go to check out all the stuff you're doing right now?
Yeah, I'm doing a lot on Twitch. Go to twitch.tv/Scott Klopfenstein, I stream every Tuesday and Friday at 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. If you go to scottklopfenstein.com, we have a bunch of shows coming up. I'm restarting an old band of mine called the Littlest Man Band, and we're doing shows. We have a show in Scottsdale, Arizona on June 11th at the Pub Rock Live. We have a show in Seattle at the High Dive on July 8th, and then at the House of Blues in Anaheim on July 15th. And there's more shows coming. And then I'm currently finishing up mixing two songs that we're probably hopefully going to be releasing in the next month or so, and going back into the studio to start recording some more tunes. Just busy, busy, busy. I'm a busy boy. Nice. And you can find me at Scott Klopfenstein on Instagram and Twitter and the Facebooks and the... I'm supposed to be doing TikTok, although I don't like it, but it's actually just intimidating.
You can.
I'll be honest. I'll be an honest old, 45-year-old man. It's like, it's scary to me. What it is though, is it's like, I'm like, I just got a new dog, and she and I are like, she's everything I focus on right now. My kids are even like, oh, you love the dog more than, not that my kids like hang out with me. They don't want to spend time with their dad, but they're like, oh, you spend more time with the dog than us. And I'm like, you have been blowing me off for years. Don't get weird.
Look,
with me.
TikTok loves some dogs. You can combine those two loves and you'll be fine.
Yeah. Just shots of my dog and a filter and some music. Yep. And yeah, I could it'd be huge.
This has been One Hit Thunder. One Hit Thunder is hosted by Chris Fafalius of the bands Punchline, Pack, and Another Cheetah, and produced by Matt Kelly of Geekscape.net. Underneath me, you're hearing Green Hills off the Punchline album Thrilled. Visit punchline.com for merch, tour dates, and news. Do you want to start a podcast? Then contact Chris and myself at weknowpodcasting.com for how we can make your show sound as professional as possible. Be sure to rate, review, and subscribe to us on your favorite podcasting app. And tune in next week for another episode of One Hit Thunder.
The strain. Nothing's ever gonna work out quite the way you think that it's gonna work out. Nothing's ever gonna work out quite the way you think.
You're listening to the Geekscape Network.
Hey there, I am Johnny Christ from Avenged Sevenfold, and I've got a podcast called Drinks with Johnny you're going to want to check out. I sit down with a bunch of different people from all different walks of life, from professional wrestlers to actors, comedians, fighters, musicians, everything in between. I'm just looking to make some friends and have a good time doing it. So if that sounds like something you're into, go check out Drinks with Johnny, streaming everywhere now.
Hello out there!
Yes, hello out there, everyone. I'm Hal Schwartz.
And I'm Flynn McClain. Together, we host None But the Brave, a podcast dedicated to the music and career of Bruce Springsteen.
Bruce and E Street Band are on tour right now for the first time in 6 years, and we're taking a detailed look at what's happening on stage in our bi-weekly episodes.
We've also been recently joined by some very exciting guests, including rock journalist Warren Zanes and Stephen Hyden, Backstreet's magazine founder Charles Cross, and Barstool's Kirk Menahan.
If you're a diehard Springsteen fan, this is the show for you.
So please subscribe to None But the Brave on your favorite podcasting platform, and we hope to see you further on up the road.
Thank you so much! We'll be seeing you!